For the six Arkham fans not yet aware, Batman Arkham Asylum was originally supposed to have a release for the Nintendo Wii. Developed by Redfly Studios, this game was not simply a port of the original game that we actually got. Since the Wii wasn't capable of running Arkham Asylum with the same level of quality as its PC, Xbox 360, and PlayStation 3 counterparts, it was decided that the Wii version would actually be a different game entirely. The project never got far, with the only known product being this short demo that was put together after just a few weeks of work. The project was ultimately scrapped, seeing no further development or an official release. I won't be going in depth on this topic, since that's not my goal in this video. If you do want to learn more about this, I highly recommend watching this video by WarpingFist. It's an amazing video and well worth your time. Since the Wii version of Arkham Asylum never actually came to fruition, it's safe to say that nobody outside of those who made it will likely ever play it. The closest we'll probably ever get to playing it would be to play the original release with a Wiimote. So that's exactly what I did. For this challenge, I tasked myself with mapping the controls of Arkham Asylum onto a Wiimote. To do this, I used Steam's controller support alongside the control customization of the Arkham Asylum launcher to map the controls from a keyboard and mouse onto a Wiimote. Well, kind of. For this challenge, I didn't technically use a Wiimote. Connecting Wiimotes to Windows systems is incredibly difficult and frustrating. Even after hours of watching guides and attempting, I was still unable to connect my Wiimote. So, for this challenge, I actually used a DualShock 4. However, I did still limit myself to using only the buttons that would be present on an actual Wiimote. For simplicity's sake, just imagine that I did this challenge using a controller that looked like this. Now, the Wiimote has far less buttons than your average gaming controller, especially keyboard and mouse. So the main challenge here was figuring out what functions I could map to the same button so that I would still be able to finish the game. It took a bit of work, but this is the control scheme I finally came up with. The D-pad controls my movement. The A button controls aim gadget, quick fire batarang, and special combo takedown. The B button controls cape stun, crouch, and select previous gadget. The 1 button controls strike. The 2 button controls run, glide, and use, which aren't able to be separated from one another, as well as counter and takedown, which also can't be separated from one another. The plus button controls detective mode, grapple, and gadget secondary feature, which is things like detonating explosive gel or the sonic shock batarang. The minus button controls access menu and use gadget. And finally, the camera is controlled by none other than motion controls. I was able to enable gyroscope functionality in Steam, meaning that when I press a certain button, my controller can utilize motion controls to act as a mouse. I decided not to map anything onto the home or power button, since neither of those have ever had any functions within a game. It also serves to make this challenge harder, which hopefully will make it more enjoyable to watch. Now, with all that out of the way, let's get into the challenge. To start the challenge, I selected hard difficulty. The first fight was extremely easy and great in helping me figure some things out. I learned very quickly that having the gyroscope sensitivity at 500% was an awful idea, and I also was able to confirm that ground takedowns are possible with my current control scheme. It's always great to confirm that my control scheme allows me to perform the very useful functions that I specifically designed it to allow. The next order of business was to take down Zaz, who gave this guard an invite to club hostage. This went down about the same as it usually does, except this time I had the pleasure of getting flashbanged every single time I swung between vantage points. Yeah, Predator sections were near headache-inducing with me mapping grapple and detective mode to the same button. But, now that Zaz was down, it was time to go empty this room full of Joker gas. This room was very easy since it really just consists of grappling and helping people up. However, there was something I hadn't previously thought about that I noticed in this room. On console, changing direction during a glide works by pressing a direction on the joystick while in the air. However, PC does it a bit differently. On PC, the direction Batman is gliding is changed by moving the camera. And since my controller inputs are mapped to PC key bindings, and my camera is mapped to motion controls, Yeah, colliding was not fun. Luckily, this game doesn't have a lot of it, though. At least now we know that this truly is a Wii game, since it has annoying and unnecessary use of terrible motion controls. As punishment for thwarting his gas attack, Joker decided to send a Titan Thug to try and deal with me. This fight was a lot closer than I'd like to admit, mostly because this is where I learned the hard way that diving out of the way of Titan charges was not an option. However, I was able to survive long enough that the Titan Thug died. After defeating his ultra-scary heart attack monster, Joker realized he was no match for me and decided to run away, leaving me alone with this random guard.
Quick, get in here before more of them come!
As I found out from this cutscene, Frank Bowles kidnapped Gordon because he's actually working for Joker. Luckily, I also found out that Bowles is a moron who leaves evidence behind at crime scenes. This gave me a trail to follow, which led all the way to the first Predator encounter of the game. The first Predator encounter went about the same as it usually would. Grapple up to a gargoyle, glide down, and perform a silent or ground takedown. After clearing out the room, I continued following the trail, which led me to Bowles' dead body. With Bowles dead and Riddler now yapping in my ear, I decided to humor him by solving his riddle. The only problem here was scanning the portrait of Sharp proved to be a bit more difficult than I had anticipated. Since I have both detective mode and grapple mapped to the same button, anytime I would try to scan the portrait, Batman would immediately grapple onto the nearest gargoyle. To circumvent this, I had to grapple up to a gargoyle and then glide down to the portrait, since Batman isn't able to use his grapnel gun while gliding in this game. Although the motion control gliding really sucked, I did actually manage to scan the portrait on my first try. After this, I decided to have a short conversation with Walter.
Bowles came walking in telling everyone to come. Said something about Joker coming and two of my guys.
Was Bowles alone?
Thought he was. Then I saw Harley Quinn. She was surrounded by gate prisoners. They were just killing every ass in the room. I had no choice. I came in Bowles' ass. I could see it on the sawhorse. They had some... It looked like the commissioner was coming to my ass.
Bowles is dead.
Good. He was Harley Quinn.
After the bombshell that was finding out that Bowles is actually Harley Quinn, Batman wanted to take a nighttime drive to clear his head. Unfortunately, upon getting to the Batmobile, he was met with a large group of Joker's thugs trying to wreck it. One quick and easy brawl with these thugs later, I headed back to the trunk of the Batmobile to grab the explosive gel. I realized here that I had made a pretty stupid mistake with my controller mapping. For whatever reason, I thought it would be best to map the Use Gadget function to the same button as the menu, meaning that every single time I wanted to place explosive gel, I had to sit through this.
Around to get back on Gordon's trail.
I want everyone now.
It didn't dawn on me until halfway through the run that a much better way to map this would be to swap the Use Gadget and the Gadget Secondary Feature functions, since the secondary feature is used a lot less than the primary feature of any gadget. Anyways, I picked up a trail from Gordon's crack pipe, which I followed all the way to this building. Shaken to his core over the revelation that Bowles isn't actually dead, Batman decided to put saving Gordon aside for a moment so that he could process these emotions. The best way to do this was to go to the medical center in hopes that a therapist there could help him process these extreme feelings of betrayal. But instead, all he found was a room full of hostages. The explosive gel was put to good use in this room, as I was immediately able to take out two thugs with it, one of which might be the most clueless thug in existence. I don't know how he didn't hear that. With the last three thugs having grouped up, I decided that my best course of action would be to buy the inverted takedown. I bought it figuring it would help speed up nearly every Predator encounter in the game, only to never once even attempt to use an inverted takedown throughout the entire run. After taking down the last three thugs, I talked to the doctors, had a bit of trouble with the camera, and then headed over to help Aaron Cash. This room didn't really give me a lot of trouble, and it even gave Batman an opportunity to take out some of his anger on this inmate. Fuck that guy. The next person I saved was Dr. Chen, and he was just as easy as everyone else up till now. Up last was Dr. Young, who's being held hostage by this group of armed thugs. Throwing a batarang in this room will almost certainly get her killed, so I needed to hold the A button the entire time I was here to make sure I wouldn't accidentally quickfire a batarang when taking out the explosive gel. Despite being a bit uncomfortable, this task wasn't difficult, making Dr. Young yet another easy save. I finished off the medical center with this short predator encounter. I did run into a few issues, but nothing that caused any major problems for me. Next was the first scarecrow nightmare, which didn't end up being nearly as difficult as I thought it would be. The most difficult part about the scarecrow nightmares was that both my crouch and run buttons have other functions tied to them that cause animations to play before I'm able to crouch or run. If I learned one thing from the first scarecrow nightmare, it was that I had to start pressing buttons before I needed them. In this case, it would be best for me to start pressing these buttons when I'm in a position where Batman isn't able to do his cape stun or counter animations, like climbing out of a vent or when I'm in the air. Not doing this did get me spotted once, since Batman was in the middle of a cape stun when I was trying to make him hang off a ledge. After defeating Scarecrow, I was introduced to the enemy that would be the bane of my existence, the knife wielder. I guess they really weren't that bad, but they were very, very annoying. Usually they're easy to deal with, since all you have to do is make sure that you cape stun them before hitting them. Well, it's a lot easier said than done when you're playing with a Wiimote. The D-pad makes it so that the enemy lock-on is not nearly as precise as it would be with a joystick, and the motion control camera means that the aim isn't nearly as precise as it would be with a mouse, meaning that my ability to cape stun the guy I was actually trying to cape stun was greatly inhibited. Sneaking through the room of armed thugs to save Gordon wasn't all that difficult, since by just holding the crouch button and following a specific route, I was able to completely avoid interacting with all but two thugs. Bane, surprisingly enough, was not all that difficult. My tactic for this boss was to simply put as much distance between me and Bane as possible. That way I would have enough time to get through the counter animation and roll out of the way before he hit me. It wasn't the best strategy and did lead to a few very close calls, but it worked well enough. The first two phases were easy enough, but the third one was where I started to run into trouble. The sheer amount of thugs in the arena made it nearly impossible to avoid being hit, so I did end up purchasing an armor upgrade to fully restore my health mid-fight. After that, I focused on taking all the thugs down before finally shifting my focus to Bane. With Bane cosplaying as the Little Mermaid, Batman headed to the Batcave to do some research on Dr. Young. With this newfound knowledge, Batman knew he needed to track her down. On my way to Dr. Young, yet another enemy type was introduced, this time it being the snipers. Snipers are usually annoying, but not terribly difficult to take care of as long as you're careful. However, given the fact that the only real options after being spotted are to either run or duck behind cover, both of which I can't do without having to sit through an animation that takes 3 to 5 business days to finish, being spotted by a sniper pretty much meant death for me. Inside Arkham Mansion, I was able to take down this group of thugs with relative ease, and I even styled on them by doing a slow motion kickflip with the last one. Saving the hostages in the library wasn't anything overly difficult, and neither was the records room. After I untied his hand, Cash directed me to Dr. Young's office, which was just down the hall. Dr. Young was nowhere to be found, but Batman was more interested in her notes at this point than finding her. After finally tracking down Dr. Young's notes, Batman found out that someone had accidentally destroyed them. Luckily, he had a hot glue gun in his utility belt and was able to put them back together. After this, I went onward to Scarecrow Nightmare number 2. The second Scarecrow mission was rather easy. The crouch button isn't needed at all for a large majority of it, which allowed me to just hold the run button the entire time. That, paired with me taking my time, allowed me to get through the nightmare without dying a single time. After waking up and escaping the clock tower, I was formally introduced to the actual bane of my existence, stun sticks. The fact that my dives seemed to have about a 50-50 chance of working when I wanted it to meant that the main method of attacking these enemies was inconsistent at best. They were a pain in the ass to deal with, but lucky for me, they don't appear all that often. Saving Dr. Young from Zaz wasn't as simple as I thought it'd be, since even getting Batman to go into corner cover was a task that took far longer than it had any right to. After getting in corner cover, I threw multiple batarangs that just narrowly missed, which I am very surprised didn't get her killed. I did finally manage to hit Zaz, which appears to have done more damage to him than I had anticipated because his body completely disappeared after that. Anyways, Dr. Young exploded, I started tracking a new trail, died to these guys once, completely avoided them the second time, and then followed the trail all the way to r/Batman Arkham. After a quick stroll through the Alsoom, Batman was just about to free Quincy Sharp before he got distracted by the thought of watching Harley and Ivy half-naked and alone in a room together. But, after being blue-balled by Joker, Batman unleashed his inner gamer as he gained access to his very own Wii U gamepad. Even while playing on a Wiimote, the hacking minigame was still the easiest thing ever. It was just a little bit more time-consuming than usual, since I didn't have any vibration in my controller to tell me when I had one of the wheels in the right position. The next fight was extremely easy, as was the section where you have to free these two guards. The fight in Extreme Incarceration wasn't the most difficult thing in the world, but it was very annoying. The presence of stun sticks automatically ensured this fight would test my patience, but the added gimmick of the floor becoming electrified caused me to take damage quite a few times. By the time I finished the fight, I had only a sliver of health left, but I was able to beat it on my first try. I was also able to beat it on my first try on my second try, since after I ended my previous recording session, beating this fight didn't save and I had to do it all over again. Anyways, with Harley now locked behind bars, Batman took a scan of her handprint, and it was time to go search for Joker's Titan Super Lab. On my way there, this Redditor did try and stop me to ask if I was stupid, to which I responded by turning him into a transformer. Inside the Botanical Gardens, it was time for potentially the most annoying predator section of all time. That's not to say this room was difficult by any stretch. It really wasn't. The annoying part about this room was that there is nowhere for me to go after taking out a thug besides grappling up to the gargoyles. I'm not going to show it here just to save you all the headache, but this room had me constantly watching my screen flash white over and over and over again. Nothing all that interesting happened between this room and the aviary, so let's just skip straight there. This room tasks you with going completely undetected until you're able to take out the thug in charge of the drop the janitors into a bottomless pit lever. My first attempt didn't go too smooth. I ended up accidentally doing a drop attack on this guy after a miscalculated glide, which caused the aptly named lever to be pulled and the janitors to be killed. My second attempt was a lot more successful. Taking out the other thugs in this room was pretty easy. I made one of them take a short fall, made another one take a big fall, and watched one of them decide for himself that death was preferable to taking on Batman. With this room cleared, all that was left in the Botanical Gardens was to fight these two Titan guards. I had been building this fight up in my head the entire run. I kept telling myself that this was going to be a major test of my abilities. What it actually ended up being was the easiest boss fight in this run, and for multiple reasons. The arena you fight these guys in is big, really big. This allowed me to create very large gaps between myself and the Titan guards, which gave me plenty of time to dodge their charges. I was also very easily able to dodge their charges because rather than trying to roll out of the way like I did with Bane, I decided to just hold the 2 button and run out of the way instead. The fact that there were 2 Titan thugs and no regular thugs here also helped me a lot, since it let me focus solely on the Titan thugs and allowed me to use each one against the other. Overall, this was by far the easiest boss in this challenge by a mile. Yes, easier than even Joker. Now that the Titan production plant was destroyed, Batman grabbed the line launcher and decided it was time to visit Ginger Flower Mommy to figure out how to cure r/Batman Arkham of its insanity. She said that the only way was to collect chemical samples from Croc's lair, which we could then use to synthesize a batch of Dream's normal pills. Getting into Croc's lair was a pain in the ass because of this Deadshot wannabe guarding the only way in. Knocking him down and then line launching over wasn't exactly something I could do particularly quickly, so I was just barely able to make it over and knock him out before he killed me for the 9 millionth time. After arriving back at the intensive treatment lobby, I'm tasked with clearing this room in another Predator encounter. This time, things are a little different, though, since the gargoyles are rigged to explode if I try and use them. With my movement options as slow and limited as they are, the only place I wasn't extremely vulnerable was on top of this central room. But that still didn't mean I was completely safe up here. I died so many times in this room. It wouldn't have even been that bad if not for two things. First, every single time I died, I had to watch this cutscene over and over again. Yes, I was able to skip it, but it was still annoying to have to do even that. Second was the fact that every time I entered the room, this thug would start off by walking towards the vent I have to drop down out of. If I didn't wait for him to turn around and go the other way, then I was dead within seconds. This meant that every time I died, I was forced to sit still for a good 20 to 30 seconds before I was allowed to try again. I did finally manage to clear this room using a combination of silent takedowns, back claw pulls, and explosive gel, all paired with a ton of patience. Before moving on, I would like to take a moment to honor Razor, who died a total of 5 times during my playthrough. Rest in peace, Razor. Batman tried to die in solidarity with Razor, but ended up waking up and then just realized that this was all another hallucination caused by Scarecrow's fear toxin, leading us into the third and final Scarecrow nightmare. The third Scarecrow nightmare turned out to be just as easy as the previous one, since it only required me to crouch 2 times, both of which were right after a jump. This meant I could just start holding the crouch button while I was midair, completely eliminating the capestone animation. I did still have a few close calls, but in the end I managed to get through and defeat all of Scarecrow's skeletons on my first try. After being taken down, Scarecrow shamefully ran away in defeat before deciding to commit some questionable actions on the public elevator. Whoa! Scarecrow, you cannot just be out here stroking your sack in public like that. Jeez, am I gonna have to blur that out?
Ah, here we go. Public masturbation.
What?
In a Starbucks. That's nice.
That ain't me, man. I was the guy who was selling
toxins.
Allegedly.
I promise you this. I will give you the best criminal defense that money can buy.
Since Saul did in fact give Scarecrow the best criminal defense that money can buy, he was unfortunately put back out onto the streets of Gotham, where he immediately attempted to reoffend. Luckily for us, Croc seems to share our thirst for justice, since he stopped Scarecrow before he was able to dip his sack into the city water supply. With Scarecrow out of the picture and Croc's lair just feet away, it was time to collect the samples Ivy told me about. Croc's lair was just as annoying as I had pictured it being. Croc randomly popping out wasn't the worst thing in the world since I just left on detective mode to make spotting him easy. Hitting him after he pops out is a different story though. Quick firing a batarang rarely results in his collar actually activating, so not only did I have to find Croc with a motion control camera, I then also had to use motion controls to hit him with a batarang. And since I always had to have the batarang primed and ready to go, that meant I wasn't able to use the line launcher to speed things up. Croc's lair wasn't what I would describe as difficult, but it was certainly annoying. By the time I had collected all the samples, I had already died twice and had numerous close calls. What was even more annoying than collecting the samples was the walk back out of the lair. By the time I collected the final sample, I was almost 500 meters away from the exit, and regardless of how far I made it, the game would not checkpoint until I hit this running section. So, each of the 4 times I died on this walk back resulted in me losing literal hundreds of meters of progress. But, with enough patience, I managed to take down Croc and leave with the samples. The next task at hand was to head back to the Batcave so that the normal pills could be synthesized. Batman was able to make a small supply of the pills before Ginger Flower Mommy decided to become Tentacle Hentai Mommy. With Ivy now fully powered up, Batman would surely need his most powerful weapon if he wanted to stand any chance at taking her down. Shutting down the east and west pumps was an easy task. The West Pump was guarded by a small group of unarmed thugs, and since combat was becoming pretty easy at this point, I had no trouble with this. The East Pump Room was a predator section, and an extremely easy one at that. The gargoyles here aren't rigged to explode, meaning I always had somewhere to run. That, paired with the numerous explodable walls, collapsible floors, and ledges to pull people off, meant that this room was more a test of my patience than it was my skill. Now that both of the pumps were shut down, it was time to head on to the next big encounter of the game, the elevator fight. I had a game plan going into this fight that I thought would greatly help. First, I placed 3 explosive gel charges at various points in the room. This would let me instantly down the Titan thug if he was close enough to one of them, while also letting me knock a bunch of thugs down. After that, I used a bunch of the experience points I had saved up from various side activities to purchase the Special Combo Throw, Special Combo Takedown, Critical Combo Strikes, and Combo Batarang upgrades. However, as I quickly learned during the fight, only one of these was at all useful to me. Special Combo Throw was a move that I knew would be useless to me, since I intentionally didn't map it onto my controller to avoid input clutter during combat. Special Combo Takedown I did map onto my controller, though. Or at least that's what I thought. You see, the key that I assigned Special Combo Takedowns to was Y, just because I was trying to assign each function to a distinct key to help keep things neat. However, the key I ended up assigning to my controller was E, since that's what Special Combo Takedown is mapped to in City and Origins, and muscle memory got the better of me during key mapping. Now, while I technically could have just changed the controller mapping to the proper key, I felt like such a stupid mistake could not go unpunished. Therefore, I decided to keep the controller mapping as is. So, I had effectively just wasted 3 upgrade points and made this fight considerably harder than I had initially anticipated. I did end up beating the fight on my first try, but that's not exactly a terrific accomplishment since in order to do that, I had to buy armor upgrades to stop myself from dying twice. With nothing left to stand in my way, it was time to put a stop to Tentacle Mommy's reign of terror. Ivy's boss fight was every bit as annoying as I thought it would be. The inability to consistently dive meant that I had to run to avoid all of her attacks, which wasn't easy with enemies trying to kill me. Her vine traps in particular were very difficult to get away from. But, with enough persistence, I managed to get to phase 2, where I very quickly died to a random guard punching me in the face. This death did allow me to restart the fight from phase 2 with all of my health back though, so I guess I can't complain. With barely any health to spare, I finished Ivy off with my secret weapon, and then headed out to watch the fireworks. I made a point to take out all of Joker's men throwing the party. Not because I had to, but because I could. This group of thugs was quite strange, since they seemed to have some sort of agreement that it would be unfair for more than 9 people to fight Batman at once. I mean, the thugs in this series have always been notorious for waiting their turn to attack, but this is a whole other level. The fight against the 2 Titan guards and Joker's thugs wasn't too bad, but also wasn't exactly a cakewalk. Since I'm stupid, I thought the Joker's thugs would infinitely come down and try to kill me, so I figured it was best to just ignore them and focus on the Titan guards. Needless to say, leaving these thugs awake ended up making the fight a lot more difficult than it needed to be. I did die on my first attempt, but was narrowly able to complete the encounter on my second. Angry at his plans being foiled yet again, Joker exposed Batman to the latest batch of posts on r/BatmanArkham. To avoid becoming stupid, Batman quickly chugged down the bottle of normal pills, to which Joker responded by creating a new character and asking Batman what he should name it. Jokes aside, the final fight against Joker was just as easy as always. The only really difficult thing about this fight was that Batman's attacks locking onto the wrong enemies was a lot worse than usual, since the fixed camera means I can only make Batman attack in 8 directions. This did end up getting me killed once, since Joker did enough damage to me that his men were easily able to finish me off, making me the first person in human history to die during the Titan Joker boss fight. My second attempt went a lot better. I dealt with Joker's thugs, watched him fall for the same trick 3 times, and then used my power winch to trigger a controlled explosion against his face, proving that, yes, you can beat Batman Arkham Asylum with a Wiimote. If you made it to the end of the video, I want to say thank you. The support on my last video was absolutely mind-blowing, and I truly can never thank any of you enough. Also, be sure to check out the Pineapple Pie Podcast, where I'm a co-host. The podcast is dedicated to discussions about writing and media, and a new video where we discuss the side content of Arkham Asylum just released the other day. Lastly, I have a lot more subscribers than I did 2 weeks ago, so do know that I am working towards achieving a more consistent upload schedule. I'm not quite sure what that will be yet, since I am working part-time and a full-time college student, but I am working on figuring it out, so stay on the lookout for more content like this in the near future. Anyways, that's all I've got for now. See ya.